he gets so involved as if he's a boxer, and it's a scary sight.
Because I say, listen, if you don't look after your money, you're going to get one shot here to blow. Once you've ruined it, it's over. So invest your money. Invest your money while you've got it. You know, even Tyson, he's a multi-millionaire. He still goes in Aldi for his shopping. You know, he'll still go to Asda's. You know, he still looks for a bargain. Appreciate the job you're in. Do it to the best of your ability and get the best out of it.
But the only reason I was able to do it, because I was making money from trading on a morning. I mean, I was working 5 nights a week coaching kids and then 2 nights a week coaching adults. How can a man who's in such a structured, disciplined environment when it comes to trading run around like a lunatic?
And on that line of, you know, looking at the future of the young generations and pensions, the world is going to look very different financially in 20 years from now. Hello and welcome back to the T-Show, where
it's time to trade thoughts.
I'm your host, Gabriel, one of the T-Guys, and joining me,
the co-host, Poku Banks, the other T-Guy. Let's get it.
Poku, it's been 2 weeks since our last episode. What's been going on?
Yeah, an eventful 2 weeks. Even recently, you know, my birthday, big 23.
23?
Yeah.
That's why you have such smooth skin, mate.
Yeah, no, it makes sense. And with that, now I see that as my Jordan year, you know. So this is my year where I need to elevate and break all limitations upon me. So it's going to the next level, really.
Well, happy birthday. I'm sorry I missed it. I feel like a bad friend. We're team guys. We're the hosts of this show. We see each other all the time, and I didn't even wish you happy birthday.
Yeah, no, no. I came to your event, actually, on the Wednesday, so the day after.
I didn't even say anything. Yeah. I'm a bad friend.
Yeah.
Next year.
Shame. Let's see. I got you. When's your birthday?
My birthday's in July, so we've got a while.
Oh, okay.
But just as a heads up to anyone watching, if he doesn't wish me happy birthday, it's just probably like him getting back at me for being a bad friend. So it's cool. We've got over that already in advance.
Yeah. But how was your past 2 weeks anyway?
My 2 weeks, wow. A lot's happened. Been on honeymoon. Ooh. I did get married a year ago, so wow. But it's cool. But yeah, went to South Africa, safari, wow. Living my best life.
Wow.
And then coming back and straight back into work. I mean, just to like get back into, you know, the financial markets, what's been going on, the world of, you know, interest rates, inflation, banking crisis.
Yeah.
I mean, we've had a lot going on, even little things like crypto's been going a little bit mad recently.
Yeah.
There's just so much going on all the time.
No, that must be great though, in such a crazy time, you're still able to do a honeymoon. You know, that's good.
Yeah, listen, I know that I'm in a fortunate position to be able to do something like that. But at the end of the day, it's also your honeymoon. You've got to go big or go home, right?
You have to. But South Africa, that's great.
Yeah, 100%.
But lots of traders out there, aren't there?
Well, I didn't really do that much when I was on my honeymoon, Poku. You're getting a bit personal here. We kind of focused on, you know, beach, pool, relaxing.
Okay.
There was no day trading by the pool, I can promise you that. That's the next holiday when I go on holiday with you for your birthday. 24, yeah?
Yeah. We'll do that. Definitely.
So what we got going on today, Poku? What's happening in the show?
Yeah, no, so starting off, we got Marc Walton, you know, veteran trader who is the owner of the Forex Mental Pro page with over 12,500 students.
Oh,
that is the power of the internet. You can reach so many people from different spaces of the world.
You say 12,500 students?
Yeah.
This guy's good.
Very good. And not only that, to be able to manage and have that many people pay attention to his services and whatnot, it just shows that we got something good to come in and we're going to learn a lot and how we can develop and grow off as well.
That is sweet. And then obviously, straight after him, we're going to get the news from Felicity. I mean, this show does it all, right? Great conversations, keeping you updated on what's going on in the news. So yeah.
It's perfect for, you know, your morning commute or even, you know, late in the evening, grab a cup of coffee. And we've got some great coming on next after, don't we?
Oh my God. So after that, we've got Big John Fury. Now, I'm really hoping that that name rings a bell to most people. But if it doesn't, let me throw a few more names out there. Tyson Fury, Tommy Fury. Well, this is their dad. The guy that raised them. Two serial winners. I mean, are they both undefeated? They're both good.
Yeah.
And they're both big names in the industry. So that family's doing something right. And we're going to talk to him about, you know, the relation between boxing, winning, success, you know, mentality and trading and finance. We'll find that link.
Oh, we'll definitely find a link. If we done it with dating, if we done it with, you know, comedians, oh yeah, no, we'll be It'll be done.
But I do want to ask you, Poku, are you a little bit worried about him coming on?
Yeah, I've seen, you know, his press conferences, the banging on the walls. You know, I've seen him take off his shirt multiple times. He gets so involved as if he's a boxer, and it's a scary sight. But, you know, let's see how he performs in like a calm environment.
Well, you never know at the end of the day. Like I said, we're not going to promise you that this is going to be like a press conference, because those are crazy.
Yeah.
But we also don't know that it's not going to be like a press conference today. So, I mean, there's only one way to find out what happens, and that's to watch the show.
Exactly. And
see Poku fight John live here in the studio today in the red corner.
That'd be crazy.
Anyway, let's dive into the show where
it's time to trade thoughts with Marc Walton.
Sweet.
Yeah. Welcome back to the T-Show. We got the one and only Marc Walton with over 12,500 students and the owner of the Forex Mentor Pro page. How are you doing?
I'm very well, thank you. Thank you for inviting me.
How's your journey here?
It was very nice. I flew EasyJet. Didn't go push the budget. Came from Portugal yesterday. So yeah, it's good to be here.
Yeah, the weather drastic change must be.
We had originally lived in the Canary Islands for 20 years, and the weather there is superb because in the winter it's 20 degrees, it very rarely rains, and 300 days of sunshine.
I'm the only one that likes the winter.
Yeah. You're pale.
You don't go out in the sun. Oh, I don't mind it. I like a bit of rain, a bit of snow, a bit of wind.
No, I hate the cold. I always have loads of clothes. We come to England in the winter, my wife's not bothered. I have every photo. I have a hat on, I have a scarf on, I have the gloves on. I'm pathetic.
Yeah. No. I think at times, like the damp weather, London looks cool, but I think weather really impacts the mood.
Oh, big time.
I think. Yeah, I get happier.
I was obviously using South Africa as well. It must have been great.
It was 25 degrees. I struggled.
Living life.
But the main thing for me with we're here to discuss, obviously, is trading. Mm. And it's the trading that has enabled me to be able to choose to live where I want to live. And now, my average client pre-COVID, and it's almost nowadays, is everything's pre-COVID or after COVID, but was 50 plus thinking about retirement. My average client now, private, is your age. And they all want freedom.
Yeah.
And they're kind of saying, COVID has taught us, I don't want to do corporate work. I don't want to be tied to something for the rest of my life. And if you think about it, how old are you now?
23.
23. You will quite probably live till you are 90 or 100.
I hope so.
Seriously. Yeah. The average age in the UK has gone from 69 to 83 in one generation. There's more than 100,000 people in Japan who are older than 100.
Mm.
So the point is, why get involved in something if you're not passionate about it? You know, why would you want to go do a job? You know what the acronym JOB stands for? The job?
Just over broke.
Just over broke. That's most people. My daughter, when she left university, didn't know what she wanted to do. And I said, the last thing you want to do is get a job. Because if you get a job, you will get on the wheel and you will be working to pay rent and to pay transport, buy food, and you'll get to the fourth week of the month, like most other people, kids in the UK, you won't have enough money.
I mean, I always do say to that, I understand, but there is a place for someone as well that's the life they want. They're happy in a life where they have their routine, they know what they're doing, when the hours and they're working, and the hours when they're not working, they're not working.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I do understand that side of it, but at the same time, they still need to be given the knowledge to make that decision.
To make the choice.
And they're not necessarily being given that.
Do you know, if you owe £1,000, £3,000 on a credit card, and you only pay the minimum every month, have you any idea how many years it takes to pay that $3,000?
25.
31.
Oh, I was so close.
31. And 8,000 interest.
Yeah, I know.
I mean, my father was terrible with money, and he had credit cards for years that when he died and I had to go sort the mess out, it wasn't sort out what I'd inherited, it was sort the mess out, there was nothing left. But he'd had credit card debt for tens of years.
That's why we're here. We want to try and educate people. And hopefully we can level up people's financial knowledge through these kind of scenarios.
Exactly.
By talking to people like yourself, experience, and hopefully sharing some wisdom ourself.
Yeah, no, I've noticed your mindset is very advanced, especially for, you know.
My mindset? Yeah. For an older person. Go on,
go on, say it.
Yeah, for
23-year-old Poku. Yeah,
yeah. No, for
26. Like
for someone that's lived on the earth for a while.
Yeah.
You know, and you expect...
You know, stop digging.
Yeah, no, you respect like you know, just a simple get a job type of mindset. But
no.
I mean, when you send in your biography, it makes sense because you've lived 10 different lives in your lifetime. You know, I've seen musician on there, lorry driver, restaurateur, builder, property developer,
football coach.
Yeah, it's
trader.
Yeah.
It's .
The irony is that trading funded everything. And the other thing, I was a coach in the Spanish second division for futsal. It sounds grander than it is, because when you coach the second division, it's regional. So I just coached in the Canary Islands. But we were playing some of the team's ex-pros. But the only reason I was able to do it, because I was making money from trading on a morning. I mean, I was working 5 nights a week coaching kids. Mm-hmm. And then 2 nights a week coaching adults. And I was getting on a plane every other weekend to another island with the adults to play a game, and then get back Sunday and be ready for the market open.
That's good fun, isn't it? Well, we do have to ask, out of all of those jobs, is trading the best?
Oh, trading has been very good to me, and trading is very good in that if I suddenly need money, I can make money. But not, trading is not the be-all and end-all for me. Trading generates the money to give me the choice to do what I want to do. Mm. So my philosophy, I'm not addicted to it, but I also don't just trade Forex. I did very well out of crypto, 2020, 2021. I took on private clients again, and also the members of Forex Mentor Pro, and I explained why I thought that crypto was going to really kick off. And we got in well. I mean, the first Bitcoin I bought wasn't a good buy. I bought it in February 2020 at just under 8,000. The following month, the COVID crash came and it dropped to 4,000. But because I understood the blockchains and what was going on, I was convinced it was going to work. So I took people on at $8,000. And then in the October, we did a launch to the general membership. And the gains that we made were insane in 9 months. I made more money personally in 9 months than I did in the previous 20 years.
Wow.
Now, Bitcoin has started again in recent days. And I was showing Poco and I, before we started, was sharing tips. And this is a trade I've done. But 2 weeks ago, I explained to people, crypto is a no word in a lot of cases, and the banks, you can't talk about it. But I showed them how, using stock, an American stock, which is a blue chip stock, you can actually invest in Bitcoin, and it's more tax efficient because you don't pay, you could do, buy the stock within an ISA and you don't pay tax. Mm. But the stock went up 35% in 10 days, but it's linked to Bitcoin.
Mm.
But the reason I knew how to do it was I used exactly the same technique I use for my trading, for Forex, for crypto, and for stocks, and for gold. So the beauty is, if you can learn it, and it's really simple what I do. I've looked at all the interviews you guys have done, and it's really strange because you had Jason Sen on, and Jason was one of these traders in the pit when they're shouting and screaming at each other.
Yeah.
And I say, I started as Billy No Mates in the basement, mm-hmm. and yet we both at the end do virtually the same thing.
Yeah.
And it's all, keep it simple. You don't need fancy indicators. To me, it's just all repeatable patterns.
Mm.
You look at, you don't, when things shoot up, dive in, you wait for it to come back. And there's a saying in trading is, you make the profit, we're paid to wait. And so the Bitcoin, I'd waited 6 months for Bitcoin. This week I had a trade, this week three trades, one on the euro pound. And I am known for being spookily accurate for the entries.
Mm.
I pick them from hundreds of pips away, but it is not rocket science. I look at Fibonacci, I look at trend lines, I look at the trend, I look at the daily range, and I look where did it bounce last time? Mm. And Bitcoin, when Bitcoin went to 67,000 and then it dropped, it came back down around 30, which is where it struggled on the way up.
Mm.
So it was obvious, if it was going to stop anywhere, it was probably going to stop there. And that's what trading is. You don't need to make it overcomplicated. You don't need super sophisticated computer systems. I bought them all. And I regularly get offered things. Will you promote this? I hardly ever promote anything because most of it is not needed. Mm-hmm. You just need to understand the basics of it.
You said this, there's a keep it simple is a philosophy that's worked for you.
Yes.
That you think and that you see working. I see it working in other aspects of my life, especially in finance as well. When I speak general finance, personal finance.
Yeah.
Keep it simple. You can go and start learning the more complicated stuff, leveling it up. But for the majority of people, the simple is enough.
Yes.
But on the flip side of that, like, you have taught a lot of people. You've got a massive audience of people that listen to you. I'm sure you've seen a number of people do well, but a number of people not do well. What are the biggest pitfalls you're seeing in trading?
the ones who do the worst often are the ones that start off the best. Because I've had people come to me, I had one particular guy, we have a weekly life training session, and I was talking in this training session explaining about a guy that came to me, started to do really well, doubled his account in 3 months, did it again in 3 months, quit his job, started trading for family money, and you know where it's going to end. He'd been on the biggest winning streak ever, and he blew the lot. And then he'd got family that he owned money to, and never trade for family. And then while I was doing this live training session, there was an Australian guy in the room, and he said, I took 2,500 to 75,000 in 3 months. And I was reading the chat, and I thought it was a misprint. I thought it was 2.5 to 75. But I spoke to him afterwards, it was true. And he'd been on the biggest winning streak everywhere. And he'd been financially struggling. Suddenly he thinks that he's now going to be a multimillionaire. He's looking at brochures for Porsches and everything. And he lost it all in one night. And again, he'd just been on the biggest lucky streak ever. It's difficult to tone people down. And unfortunately, a lot of people don't listen. So we have a guy at the moment, we've just done a case study from him. He joined us 8 years ago. I mean, a lot of our students joined a long time ago. We started in 2008. So a lot of them, they're not necessarily active anymore. But this gentleman is 63 now. He started when he was 53. And he said, when he came in, there's a bit at the beginning, right at the beginning of the course, that says, right, the first most important thing you need to do is create a business plan. And it's a business stroke life plan. What are you trying to achieve? What period of time? And let's be realistic. You will not get rich quick at this. And I talk about all the different things that you need to do to put the foundations in properly to be able to do this. And most people kind of go, woof, that's boring. Right, let's get on to the technical. Let's get on to the charts. This is the sexy stuff. So this guy, David's just written a thing where he came back in June. And he said, right, I realize now I should have listened to Mark in the first place. And I even had a guy last year from Sunderland. He's been with us 10 years and he attends the weekly live sessions regularly. And he sent me an email last year. He said, you know what? I finally thought, oh, sod it. I'm going to do what he's been banging on about for 10 years. And you know what? It actually works. But the problem is that people come in and they think, well, okay, what he's doing works, but I only risk 0.5% per trade, but I'm looking for 2 or 3% return. Mm. I don't need to win more than 50% of the time. I can actually be profitable at 40%. And being from a sports background, that's difficult because we're brought up, we want to win and losing is bad. Yeah. Well, actually it's not, it's just math. And as long as you are taking trades that will give you at least 3-4 times the risk, you only need 1 in 3 to be profitable, which is a real mind shift and difficult for a lot of people.
100%.
But this general thing is everybody wants to get rich quick. The crypto actually spoiled young people. Because I had a good friend of mine, his son was at university. I said, just ask him how many of his mates are in crypto. The whole university is in crypto. And as we know, it's gone up. It's up another 50% this morning. This is easy. Life's going to be, and now suddenly it's not. But I was trading stocks in the 90s, the dot-com boom. In those days, you used to have to ring the broker up to place a trade. And I stayed in too long because I got caught up in all of it. We're all going to get rich quick. This is easy. But it's 20 years later before we had really another brilliant occasion, and that was crypto. And it might be another 10 before it comes again. The other thing is don't just learn to trade. Have another skill, because you don't need to spend more than an hour a day doing this. And therefore, if you can learn another skill. So the main investment you should make is to learn something that preferably online that you can do, whereby you can generate some income. And even if you only make £200 a week from this and £200 for that and £50 from this, it doesn't matter. So if you have a bad month from trading, you're still going to be okay. Because the worst case in trading, I was doing it only trading for 5 years. And if you go into a slump, and we all go into a slump, no matter what they say, we will all go. To dig your way out is like digging your way out of debt. It's twice as hard when you're in debt to get back to naught than it is to go forwards. So realistic expectations. Create a business plan, a life plan, work out the trading rules and stick to them.
Yeah, definitely. I think, especially with trading, I always like to tell people, always be doing something else. Because I think once you're relying on trading to live on, that's when your psychology is all over the place. You're trading as if, you know, this has to work. And I think giving yourself time to breathe and learn and maneuver the markets it's so much easier on my mindset, especially.
Yeah.
Do you have an approach to turn people away when they come in to trade? And do you encourage a lot of people to trade, or do you really think there needs to be a specific person when it comes to this?
Anybody can do it in theory. Anybody with a reasonable level of intelligence can do it. There are certain industries that accountants generally struggle. And I think it's because 2 + 2 always equals 4 for an accountant. Whereas in trading, I can do the best analysis going and this is the spot and it doesn't work. But I will still take the same thing next time because it will probably work. So they struggle. Sports people struggle. As I said earlier, we want to win. We want to win. We want to win. No, you don't need to win. You just need to be calm and wait for it to come to you and when you win a decent amount.
So then in terms of strategies that you may teach beginners or those on your as your students, how do you go about and what type of strategies do you like to implement?
I have one strategy mm-hmm. I've used for 20 years.
Wow.
And all I've done over the years is take more and more things off. So I now start with a very simple chart. I use the 200 EMA and the 55 EMA. I use trend lines and I use Fibonacci, which Gabriel's probably but the thing is to a technical trader, mm-hmm. then that you it's understand where I've come from.
Yeah, it's pretty
simple. So it's not complicated, but I look at structure first. And what I say to people is look at a weekly chart to start with and look to see, is it going up? Is it going down or is it going sideways? Because if it's going up, we want to buy. If it's going sideways, we have a different bet. We will look to buy on the polar. And if it's going down, we want to sell. It's that simple. So you're looking at the structure. Then I go to the daily and I am then looking for multiple reasons to support the theory that if this thing drops, it will probably bounce here mm-hmm. for multiple reasons. And I look for 5 reasons.
Mm-hmm.
So that could be the trend. It can be a Fibonacci level. It can be previous major support and resistance. It can be a whole number, as silly as it is, with a lot of pairs. So you look for 5 reasons I teach people to look for, and is it going up, down, or sideways? And then the only difference would be is if there's some big news out, say the Australian news usually comes out in the middle of the night for us, wait until the news has come out. But other than that, I would place the order at the market open. So it's not complicated. The other part of the equation is when you're looking for a trade, it must have the possibility to make at minimum twice what you risk.
Yeah.
And ideally 3 or 4 times. So on that basis, you can win 1 in 3 and still be profitable.
Mm.
You don't have to win all the time. You don't have to take many trades. You just need to wait. And so I was telling you earlier, I did a trade last week in a live training session with my students. I'd seen that Bitcoin had broken out of a triangle, which technically, as you know, is an important area. So what I said to my students, if you're not interested in crypto and it scares you and you can't put money in because the banks won't let you, you don't want all the hassle with the wallets, one of the ways that you can do this is to use a US stock called MicroStrategy. And MicroStrategy had broken a trend line and a 55 EMA, and it was following Bitcoin. Why is MicroStrategy important? Do you know why MicroStrategy is important when it comes to Bitcoin?
No idea.
MicroStrategy own 158,000 Bitcoin worth $5 billion. So if Bitcoin goes up and they've got 158,000 at an average buying cost of 29,000, their price will shoot up. So from my telling my clients and students, it shot up, it nearly went up 40% in the end in 10 days. But that was just structure. Has it been going up, down, or sideways? Has it consolidated in an area? Is it breaking an area? And fundamentally, well, Bitcoin's gone up. They've got 158,000 of them. It's not going to go down. So again, start on the big picture. Look at structure. And just everything to do with trading is probability. If it drops, where's it probably going to bounce? For as many reasons as possible.
Yeah.
And that's all you need to do.
You make it sound simple.
It is simple. But it's this that screws everybody because they get greedy and emotion and silly.
Yeah.
I was telling a tale yesterday. I have a guy I'm just teaching now. He is a deep sea diver in the North Sea, and it's one of the most dangerous jobs in the world. There's 3 of them go down in a capsule for a week at a time. And it's pitch black, and he's shown me it's terrifying. But it's the kind of job, it's one of the most dangerous in the world, and he and his 2 other guys down there have to follow every health and safety protocol to the letter, or somebody could die. I'm teaching him Forex. 2 weekends ago, he'd been with me a fortnight, he spotted a really good trade, and when the market opened, the spread was 15 times wider than it should be, and he took the trade. And I said, you're running around like, there used to be a character in the Muppets that used to run around with his hair on fire. And I said, how can a man who's in such a structured, disciplined environment when it comes to trading, run around like a lunatic?
Well, I've always been, when it comes to the UK, I've always told my friends, you know, I would rather focus on conquering the UK. So in terms of maybe setting up a business here, making sure I got my network here, and then branching out. Well, what do you think about, or do you think that's the UK? And this,
hope you've been done that. Yeah.
No, but you're 23. Yeah. You've got your whole life in front of you. It's like pensions. I mean, I briefly sold pensions for a UK bank.
Yeah.
And I am not a big fan of pensions for young people. I think it's nonsense. Yeah. You know, if you're 23,
I disagree.
You were banking. We can have that one in a minute. But you, at your age, could quite probably live till you're 100.
Yeah. I wish.
But seriously, and healthily to 100. Because the life expectancy is going up all the time. The downside is the pension scheme for the government pension is going higher and higher. So whether there is still a government pension when you retire, at the moment it's now you've got to be 67, used to be 65. Mm-hmm. The governments have not got enough money and we have an aging population. So they're going to keep pushing it. So when you retire, it will be 80. Mm-hmm. So do you want to start putting money away now for 60 years' time? And do you want to follow the mantra of, always put money in stocks because you always make money? That's not true either.
I think there are other ways of putting money away. So even if it is in property, for example, that's still money for your future. The reason why I do believe in pensions is because time is one of the biggest assets for money.
Yeah.
It is. It really is. So I do encourage people at a young age that, okay, you might not think that £50 a week will do anything for you because it sounds like nothing. Mm. But the truth is, if you're putting that away from the age of 20, or 18, all the way up to the age of 60, 70, 80. Mm. It's just a little bit just to give you that security because so many people are hitting retirement age, not able to retire, having to continue working, nothing in savings. I think the average like mean savings at retirement age is probably around £50,000 in the UK. Now, don't quote me on that number.
It's about 75.
£75,000. Can you live off £75,000 in your bank account for the next, now you said 30 years of your life? Yeah. That's why I do encourage people to think long term. Maybe it doesn't have to be labeled as a pension, but just something put away towards an age in your life where you're hoping to not have to rely on bringing in an income.
The point I'm making is I'm not saying don't buy stocks, but it's the timing. Mm. So for example, if in 2008 you'd been saving for 40 years and you have £1 million in your pension fund, when the stock market crashed in 2008, it dropped 58%. So your million, you're going to retire next week, your million's just gone down to 480,000. Mm. And people say, yeah, but it always comes back. It took 5 years for the S&P to recover. But gold tripled within those 5 years. So just like I mentioned earlier about crypto, if you catch the right time, you can make a lot of money. Somebody said to me recently, if you had to start again, what would you do? I would buy property. And the reason I would buy property is, I looked at an exercise this morning. If you put £8,000 into the S&P in 1970, the average, you could buy two houses at that time, or you could put it in the S&P. Now it would be worth £1.5 million, and those two houses would only be worth £500,000, because the average house price nowadays is £250,000. But the second house would have been, if you did a conventional mortgage, would have been paid off by 1995. So it would be have been giving you income for 28 years now. And this year, it might be giving you £2,000 a month.
Mm.
And the point of that then is, instead of putting money away for 60 years' time, you could draw that money on a regular basis. It also gives you the freedom to say, okay, if you really wanted to do something, you could sell one of the properties. And as you get older, tax-wise, there are advantages. You can put larger amounts in. So I'm not saying I disagree with it per se, but the timing. So for me, I don't think for a 20-year-old, it's the best advice.
Yeah.
Stocks always make money, but stocks are cyclical.
Well, I'm hoping what someone takes out of this really is there are options. And don't just take things because someone tells you.
Exactly.
Do your own research. And there's a number of right decisions. This is what I like to people. Everyone's scared of making the wrong decision. I say there's a number of right decisions you can make. One of the most important ones is to actually make a decision.
Yes, do something.
Yeah. Do something, be active and be conscious and educate yourself on that topic. And on that line of, you know, looking at the future, the young generations and pensions, the world is going to look very different financially in 20 years from now. Very, very different.
It may not even be the same as it is now.
I think it's going to be a full 180.
Yeah. You look at AI. You had the conversation with Jason saying about the AI for trading. That's a different conversation. But the thing is now, when I was a kid, there used to be a program in the 70s called Tomorrow's World. And they were trying to interpret what was going to happen by the year 2000. And they thought there'd be flying cars. And nobody could even imagine the concept of the internet. And things did change. I mean, there was lots of things happened. But the last 10 years, things are moving so quickly. I think one of the Amazon factories now that used to employ hundreds of people is employing like 10. Because there's robots flying everywhere. The only thing they need people for at the minute is to take stuff off the conveyor belt and put it onto the robot. Now, they announced last week that they're testing robots to pick things off the conveyor belt to put it. So you've got that level of work's gone. You've got the supermarket now. A Tesco near where my daughter lives in Middlesbrough used to have 27 checkouts. There's 4 now. Everything else is self-checkout. Yeah. So those jobs have gone. And then you look at train drivers. I think it's Saudi Arabia. The whole network, the whole metro system is no drivers. So if all those jobs are going to go, and anything, I talked to a lawyer recently and he said there's a lot of jobs going to go in the legal world because a lot of the admin work is done for people searching for the documents and case examples. You just ask ChatGPT now. And again, accountancy, most of it can be done automatically. So then if you're going to end up with millions and millions of people around the world for whom there is no work, there's no realistic possibility of work. They tested in Switzerland last year, and they're testing it in the UK now, is what's called universal income. And what that will mean is everybody, they're going to get rid of all the social security system and the tiers of government, and everybody will be given £2,000 a month, whether you're working or not. If you work, then you can earn more. But the thing is, if you have tens of millions of people with no jobs and no prospect of a job, you're going to end up with rioting and revolutions and all the rest of it. So the rich need to keep a lid on it by spreading the wealth around. Give the money to people. So it may be, as you've started the conversation, quite right. I think so. I think within 20 years, the current financial system will not be the same because everything at the minute is geared to growth. Every country has to increase its GDP. Every country has to make more stuff every year to sell to more people.
Yeah.
But there is a drop in the birth rate in the Western world, so there might be fewer people. And there are minerals and things that we'll run out of. So you can't keep making stuff to make more. So I think the world will change. And again, that's why I wouldn't be in a rush to commit to something 60 years ahead. Now, property gives you flexibility. There are not enough houses in the UK and everybody needs somewhere to live.
So the flip side to this conversation is this idea of with the new technology brings new possibilities.
Absolutely.
And new opportunities.
Absolutely.
So we know it's a fact that there are going to be millions of jobs disappearing, but maybe the same way that the internet was created, yeah, millions of opportunities are going to be coming. So what's your approach? What's your ideas to young people today? How do you prepare yourself for this new world coming so that you will put yourself in good stead, even if it's to do with trading specifically, to take it on?
Teach yourself a skill. Learn a skill. Learn trading. Learn. I mean, I bought my kids one Christmas, you know, they're unwrapping presents, and one of which is a course on how to build a website. And it's like, oh God, now what's he doing? But all my kids could build websites. My youngest daughter, the one that went to Australia, is still touring the world. She's a photographer as well. But she is able to build websites. That will probably go with AI. But she's made a good living for the last 7-8 years. So learn a skill, a practical skill that people need, and ideally that you can use online. Or if you're more physical, get a trade. Learn to be a plumber. You know, still people are going to have to crawl under floors to put pipes in and things that AI won't be able to do, and electricians and things. And if you learn that kind of skill, you could do that anywhere in the world. So just learn more of a skill. Do not depend on your job to be there in 20 years' time, and don't start devoting yourself to a career for something. You know, think the implications through. Could a machine do what I'm doing? Could it do it better, quicker, and smarter than me, and cheaper, and won't go on strike? Well, if that's the case, you need to start thinking now about another way for what to do in the future.
With AIs entering the trading space, have you ever thought, you know, there are AIs trading for people, making money for people, the bots out there. Do you think that will ever affect us retail traders trading manually, or you always see that as another side of the market, which if someone wants to enter, they can.
We've always had, the last 10, 15 years, we've had a level of automation. The banks have all got automated software, a lot of which appears to be influenced by Fibonacci, which is why I think Fibonacci works. So often you will see price will hit the 78.6 Fib and bounce straight off it. Well, if all the banks and the funds are using technology with that inbuilt, then it becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy. So we've already got a level of automation. I talked to a programmer last weekend and I said, to me, what would be a concern is if everything was perfect because it's learned from its mistakes, would we end up with a situation where price doesn't move? Because, and then we've got a problem because nobody can make any money. But then again, because the funds and the banks make so much money from it, they're not going to play that game.
Yeah.
So he said exactly the opposite. He said, because each piece of AI is going to be programmed slightly differently, and he thinks there will actually be more extreme moves. But at the end of the day, I have no idea. Nobody has any idea. And to answer your question about kids for the future, nobody knows. The internet, nobody dreamed of the internet. When the internet started, there was a famous Nobel Prize winning economist called Paul Krugman, who said that it'll never catch on. It'll be like the fax machine. It'll be gone in 5 years. And this guy is still writing in the New York Post. And he said the other week, if you take food, housing and heating out of the inflation figures, we're back at 2%. Hang on a minute. If food inflation's still at 15% and house, you think of the rents in London, how much they've gone up, 10, 20, 30%.
Yeah.
How can you turn around and say, well, we'll take food and housing and heating out of the... This guy's a Nobel Prize winning economist.
We take the three most important core elements of our life out of our life. Everything's
great. Yeah. It's insane. So, and again, you need to be able to read things. I said to a kid years ago, if a survey comes out and it says, listen, eating beef burgers is really good for you, just think who paid for the survey. And so if somebody from a bank says to you, oh, we're buying the euro today at 106 with a target 108, a bank, to my knowledge, is not a charitable institution. The only reason they're telling you is because they've got a load of it at 108 they want to sell, then they want you to pile in and buy it so they can sell it.
Yeah.
So you've got to learn to cut. You talked earlier about there's so much information. You really need to peel it all back and just be very cynical and just say, okay, I have a few people I recommend, and I'll send you the links later on. And another thing I would give you had Richard was on last week, and he kept pulling presents out behind the plant. I will give you a $60,000 present. If you want to understand what really happens with Bitcoin and blockchain, there is an MIT course on YouTube, completely free. It's a 20-hour session, so it's a slog. But if you want to understand blockchains, which is why crypto is so important, you can watch that course, and the students on that course have paid $60,000 for that course.
On that note, thank you very much for our present. I just want to say thank you so much for...
Thank you for inviting me.
For this, that was brilliant. I think so many insights. Poku?
Yeah, no, I definitely learned a lot. Definitely going forward, and we'll definitely look to apply that, especially that course.
Yeah. I think more older people should be willing to share experience, but not in a negative way. Mm. The world is a beautiful place still. There's more good people than bad. And you really need to get out there and enjoy it while you can, you know?
I like that. Always end on a note of positivity. Yeah. There are opportunities if you're willing to work hard, search and educate yourself on them.
Must educate yourself.
Which we have done for ourselves today selfishly by taking all of your knowledge from you. So thank you for that.
You're welcome. Nice to meet you both. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Marc, so much for your time, your knowledge and your wisdom here on the show today. And now we're heading straight over to Felicity, who's going to be bringing us the latest financial news, what's going on. So enjoy.
Hi, Poku, and hello, Gabriel. It's great to be back with you tea guys and with this week's hot topics. I'll be taking a look at predictions that the US is set for recession in 2024 and what that might mean for interest rates. We'll hear why, despite the downturn, asset managers are starting to see green shoots in China. And speaking of green shoots, there are predictions that European stocks could see a pretty positive 2024 with rising wages, less recessionary risk, and possibly even interest rate cuts. All of that coming up. Now, I don't know if you've started your Christmas shopping yet, but the new year isn't far away. And while a lot of us make New Year's resolutions, UBS has been making some predictions. It's predicting that the US economy is going to roll into recession in 2024, driven by economic headwinds like rising unemployment and households that are simply running out of savings they've been using to support their spending. Anyway, that's the bad news. The potential good news is that UBS thinks inflation is going to come right down, and that's going to lead to the Fed cutting interest rates by a whopping 275 basis points. Now, that is more than four times what the markets are pricing in. But the Swiss bank reckons that falling inflation and then a desire to support the economy is going to lead to some pretty steep cuts in interest rates. The Fed's Committee on Monetary Policy has hiked interest rates 11 times since early 2022. So those cuts would come as a relief for a lot of investors. Now, we've had lots of negative news coming out of China over the last few hot topics, including new US sanctions, rising household debt, falling exports, and of course, those ongoing concerns about the wider impact of the real estate crisis there. But not all traders are singing the blues when it comes to the world's second largest economy. In fact, some have started questioning whether there's potential in the country's depressed stock markets, especially if the US economy is likely to wobble into recession in the coming months. A number of fund managers have told the news agency Reuters that they expect improvements in Chinese earnings, particularly as consumer demand recovers and the government continues to inject stimulus through state spending. And they aren't the only upbeat forecast. The International Monetary Fund thinks the Chinese economy will grow at 5.4% this year, although it is likely to slow down to 4.6% in 2024. But even that prediction of 4.6% growth is an improvement. As recently as October, the IMF had been talking about expected growth of 4.2%. Now, many people think the weaker Chinese currency just now has made it harder for the central bank to slash interest rates in order to help the economy recover. But the People's Bank of China did increase its support another way. It pumped more money into its financial system through one-year policy loans. In fact, the cash injection is the biggest since 2016 and went beyond what some analysts had expected. Shall we have another prediction? It's that time of year, isn't it? Strategists at Goldman Sachs have an upbeat outlook for European stocks in 2024, predicting a jump of 7.5% compared to current market levels. Now, its analysts are pointing at an improving economic outlook, a fall in the risk of recessions, and growth of 0.9%. Now, that might not sound like the most impressive growth Europe has ever seen, but it's a definite improvement on the 0.5% growth expected this year. Goldman's also predicting interest rate cuts as the European Central Bank sees inflation continue to fall. But can inflation keep calm and carry on falling? That's the question. And a recent IMF blog suggested that the economic recovery is being helped by rising wages across the zone. And it warned that the Eurozone needs to see improved productivity alongside those rising wages. Otherwise, there's going to be an ongoing inflation risk. Solving the productivity problem is absolutely key for long-term sustainable growth. Anyway, there is certainly no productivity problem in the tea studio. So Gabriel and Poku, I will hand back to you tea guys. See you next time.
Thank you so much, Felicity, for bringing us the latest financial news. And now on to a very special guest, the man that we teased a little bit about in the intro to this show. We're bringing you Mr. John Fury, father of Tyson, Tommy and Roman Fury, who are all paving the way. Well, some of them have paved the way in boxing and also a professional boxer yourself.
Yeah.
Welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me on your show. Great to be here.
Anyway, I want to dive straight in to mindset because I know just how big that is in boxing. I mean, throwing around words like discipline, resilience, consistency. These are terms that I suppose you hear both in the financial world, but also in the boxing world. So as someone who has succeeded, has kids that have succeeded really well, how do you go about creating these environments where you create such strong mental resilience?
Well, it's from an early offset, really. You know, as children, if you want them to do well, you've got to put time into them. And I put a lot of time into all of my sons. I've got six sons, and I put a lot of time into all of them, not just the ones in the limelight. And I feel if you get them on the right path from a young age and tell them it's all about thinking and mindset and thinking before you act, if you can get them two things right from the early age, everything else will fall into place. And they wanted to do it. They've got to want to do it. They've got to want to be successful in their own right, you know. And I've learned them to be that way. Don't follow your brothers. You're individuals. Do your own thing. Have your own personality in your own life. And be proud of what you do, not what your brother can do. What I can do is what you can do that matters. Yeah, and that's the that was the blueprint for all of my sons.
I'm already hearing similarities, this idea of don't follow the other people's path, because you have to do it yourself. You have to learn yourself. You have to experience yourself to be able to build those mindset. I mean, with money and finance, we say the same thing. You can't just copy what someone else is doing with their money, because what works for them isn't going to work for you. And one day you're going to have a challenge that someone else hasn't faced that you've got to figure out for yourself, and you haven't, you know,
very much so,
built your own mindset.
One man's meat's another man's poison, you know. And at the end of the day, it's what you want to do and what you're happy doing. And if you're comfortable doing it, you'll succeed. But you've got to love what you're doing as well. If you're distracted and you're not 100% engaged on what you're focusing on, it won't work. It's got to be 100%.
I want to flip it quickly, because obviously you coach your sons, yeah, but you see hundreds of other boxers. What are other people doing wrong with their mindset?
It's not what they're doing wrong. Not everybody's a natural fighter. Fighters, what's got a natural mindset, what don't need too much coaxing, don't need too much training, they're what I call naturals. They're good in every way. They're going to succeed. They've got the talent, they've got the ability, they've got the mindset, and they've got self-belief, which is the most important thing. And if you get someone that believes in yourself, they take a lot of stopping in every avenue. And that's why there's world champions, and there's only a handful of them. Look how many people go through boxing, and how many make the grade. How many Mayweathers, how many Ray Leonards, how many Aglers, how many Muhammad Ali's, how many Tyson Furies. There's not many people what's got everything.
Harold, I mean, Poku, let's talk about the noise when it comes to money. I mean, I don't know if you ever go on social media and you see people claiming to be, you know, experts, telling you do this, do that, do this, do that.
Yeah, predicting, you know, certain crashes or saying, oh, buy this is going to go up. But in reality, you need to follow your own path, understand the markets for how you see them, and then you make your own sound decision rather than just, you know, listen to what everyone else says. I mean,
forensic.
Sure.
There you go.
It's an age-old saying, if you study your job properly and you're making money at it, never tell people how much you're making in your life, and never boast about your success, because it affects the man next to you who's not doing so well. He'll resent you for it, he'll hate you for it, and he'll never want to be your friend because of it. So what you do is keep your business to yourself, never be in anyone's face, never be a show-off, never be a big-head. As long as you're comfortable knowing in your own mind that you're succeeding every day,
yeah,
you're happy, the world's happy. And the man next to you is happy because he doesn't know what you're doing. It's like I know, years ago, if a next door neighbour got a new front door, he wanted one. If he changed his car, he wanted one. It's like repetition. They're all followers, aren't they? You know, but what you do is give them nothing to follow, in your case. And I know plenty of multimillionaires that drive old cars. They mix in. You know, you wouldn't know them from anybody, but they're happy with in their own skin. They're happy with their own success. They don't want to boast about it, but they know they've got a comfortable life, a stress-free life, because they've studied the job properly and they've done it right and succeeded. But you don't need to tell anybody about success, do you? Because everybody today on an internet can look happy when they take a photo with that phone. Anybody can smile for 10 seconds, take a picture. Okay, the world's all right. And when the phone's put down, they're crying. And it's so easy now to be a plastic millionaire, isn't it? There's all this tick. You can buy a Rolex watch for £80 a month. You can get the best of a car for £400 a month. You can look the part. Oh, are you? Mm. What are you when you look at it in cold light today? A fraud.
Yeah.
There's no substance to your game.
I mean, that's brilliantly said. I mean, there's a saying that says, you don't become a millionaire by spending £1 million. You become a millionaire by having £1 million in
And I think that's exactly what you said.
Very clever.
People are so ready to spend it, but not to save it.
They want it now.
Here and now.
But the trouble is, again, when you get a proper millionaire and you get a fake one, you'll get laughed at. It's like a diamond will shine, a stone won't, you know. And there's a lot of stones out there. I call them pretenders and wannabes. You're better off being yourself. This is who I am, you know. This is how I live my life. Take me or leave me. I'm a nice guy. I try to help people. I do the best I can. I'm considerate. What more can you be in your life? But all those things I never wanted to be. I never wanted to be a show-off, never in anybody's face, never do anything. I drive a 32-year-old car and another 25-year-old car, and I get joy out of being normal, because to me it's A to B.
Yeah.
You know, and as long as I can pay my bills and not be in debt to anyone, isn't that a success on its own?
That is, well, you're doing better than 99% of the world,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, because I always say, if you can't afford it, don't have it.
Course.
Don't have it. Yeah. You know, if you can't afford £1,000 pair of trainers, I don't care if you had $10 trillion, by the way, I'd never give £1,000 for a pair of pumps. That's ridiculous.
Unless they were really nice.
They'd have to be nice. They'd have to have got 22 carat gold soles on it, yeah, that way. So I just say, you know, it's like brands of clothes. It's all rag. It's just got a different brand on it. It's got a successful brand, and you're only buying the brand, you're not buying the quality of the clothing. Because when you put it in that washing machine after 3 or 4 washes, it's in the same street as yet Mazda. Yeah. But it's a brand, isn't it? Again.
Well, they're smart. They know what they're doing.
They know what they're doing.
And they're targeting the right. They're not targeting rich people. Let's just put it that
way. They're targeting the wannabes.
Exactly.
Oh, I want to have a Nike t-shirt. I want to have Nike trainers all in Nike. Because they want to be like that. It's like I've always said. You could live in a castle, drive an old vehicle. You think you're a no one and a bum. But you drive a nice car and live in a tent, you're somebody. Because you're being judged on what they can see. They can't see your tent. They can't see your castle. They're looking at what you're driving and what you're dressed in, you know?
Yeah, and to translate that, it's essentially irrelevant. It's a facade, isn't it? I mean,
it's a facade.
Pokey, I mean, how many things did you hear there that you'd wish you could just teach young people when it comes to money?
Yeah, no, I think people want to look the part rather than be the part, like we always said. So with that being said, it's all about how you manage your money, how you place it, and look for it to grow for further generations. Mm-hmm. So it outlasts, you know, the dynasty. So I think that definitely needs to be expressed to the youth. But again, I think with social media, there's so many distractions where you're scrolling, you've seen all these nice things.
Yeah.
You have access to all these things where maybe 20, 30 years ago, you grew up way more humble. You only saw what was around you.
So humble, isn't it?
Yeah.
You know, at the end of the day, the world today want you to be like that because it's better for business. Now, if they all thought like me, you get your shopping in Aldi, you know, food's food. A supermarket is a supermarket, whether it's Sainsbury's, Marks and Spencer's or Aldi or Lidl. It's still a shop with groceries on a shelf. But people think, oh, I don't want to be seen going to Aldi. They might look at me and think I'm an old one and I haven't got any money. Well, that's the mindset, what's being put out there today. And it's the wrong mindset. We was brought up with hardly anything. And we knew if we got hold of a pound to appreciate it and spend it wisely. And that was the reason why I can guide all my sons. Because I say, listen, if you don't look after your money, you're going to get one shot here to blow. Once you've ruined it, it's over. So invest your money. Invest your money while you've got it. Forget about the big cars. Forget about the watches. Forget about the clothes. Get your footings in order. Get your ducks in line. Get your money invested.
Like I said, that's the perfect transition point, because I want to talk to you about business now. We know that boxing, when you're successful, brings with it a lot of money and a lot of success. It's there when you're at the very top of any category, right? So as a business person, what is your approach? What are your son's approaches to handling that level of financial success?
Again, it comes down to parental guidance, doesn't it? Because if you give a 20-year-old a bank full of money, he hasn't had the lifetime experiences to handle that money, to do what's right with that money. So therefore, he has to listen to guidance. And it's all about having good people on board as well. You know, we've got some real good advice on board, not just myself. You know, we've got good lawyers, you know, and if you listen to what people's got to say, you'll keep your money. But listening to the man next to you, what doesn't really know a lot, will cost you. What you've got to do is put him in his category and you in yours. You can slam the same amount of fun when you go out. You can do this, you can do that. But you've got to realise what level you're on and what's good for you and what's good for your money, you know, and always look for a bargain.
Oh, I love a bargain.
You've got to have a bargain. Like in my house, all my stuff comes out of like auctions, charity shops, where you can get it cheap, because somebody's bought that and they've lost a lot of money in that product. But I've got that same product in my house and it's doing the same job for cheap. You know, so that to me is a win-win-win.
I really want to stress what you're saying right now. It's so important. I mean, there are people listening to this that aren't anywhere near the level of the Fury family, and especially even yourself with the success that you've had and that your family have had. And yet the way that you're talking about money and the fact that it's not about what's on the outside, it's about what's on the inside, and just listening to the way that you've approached it, the way that you spend your own money. I think that there's going to be a few people checking themselves thinking, well, wait a second. This guy's much, like, he's bigger time than I am right now. And he's, like you said, driving around in a 25-year-old car, a 30-something-year-old car, looking at charity shops, doesn't care what shop he goes to. I'm really hoping that we're hitting a hard reality. I mean, I know that even I am here, speaking to yourself, listening to how humble you are with the success that you've had. I'm learning a lot right now. There's a whole new level to play when it comes to this, like, modest game.
Yeah, 100%. I wanted to ask then, how was that translating that ideology to then the Suns? Because they're out there, you know, winning big lumps of sums for every boxing fight. Is it easier or is it a bit harder to convey that humbleness?
No, because they know by being with me most of their life, because my lads haven't done much schooling. I was the teacher, me, because I thought to myself in life, what you learn in a school's one thing, but what you learn in the real world's another. And you can have real world experiences. Like some people go to school from 4 to 16, on to further education. And they're working for somebody else for minimal pay because they can't get a job with all these skills they've got, because there's that many people to choose from out there with the same skill set. You know, and you watch all these programs like the Alan Sugars, Dragon's Den and all that, you know, and it's like, what can I say? The ordinary people, the salt of the earth people that goes on them shows, have made those millionaires what they are. But they'll never tell you that. They'll never tell you that. And the working class man, it's not his fault. It's just how he's been programmed to do it from school. If his father's done it, his mother's done it, his grandparents have done it, he's going to do it. But like me, I come from a travelling family. There were six of us in an 18-foot caravan, what, 6 foot wide. You know, we had no running water, no electricity. We washed outside. And I think before we had a bath on a hot shower, I was 17 years old. Wow. You know, and we was used to that way of life. But I got to a certain age because I used to deal with the general public and knocked on doors for a living. And one old lady changed my life forever. I was selling some carpets door to door from the back of a vehicle. I used to buy them out of a warehouse and make a small profit on them by knocking on people's doors back in the early 80s. Freezing cold day. Come in, son, she said. I was about 12. Come in. It's very cold. I went into her drawing room. She had a lovely big roaring fire. The place was lovely and warm, cosy. I thought, why can't we live like this? I said, what is this? I put my hand on these radiator tight. I didn't even know what they was then. So why is that hot? I thought, why is the side of this house hot? But it wasn't, it was a radiator. But I didn't know. You know, it was just another machine I'd not seen. And I thought, I want to be warm in the winter months. I want to do this. I want to do that. And if she can do it, I can do it. So this is the norm. And I sat talking to that lady, she was about late 60s, for about 45 minutes. And she educated me so much to the point where I wanted to live like that. And you know what? Guess what? In the next 3 years, I was living like that.
So I guess then investing in your home, that's more of like a deep-rooted, like sentimental investment, because from where you come from, having a nice home, making sure you live in a great place, it just makes you feel at peace. And
yeah, I haven't got a nice home. You know, there's a lot of people got a nicer house than me, but it's how I like it. It's what I've done in my life. I'm going to look round it. It's my success story. And probably people think it was a toilet block for an house, but it's what I've done. It's warm. It's dry. It does its job. Yeah. I've got a TV. It's full of stuff out the furniture shops and dispersal sales, but that's how I am. You know, even Tyson, he's a multi-millionaire. He still goes in Aldi for his shopping. You know, he'll still go to Asda's. You know, he still looks for a bargain.
Yeah.
Only this morning, coming here in Brighton, because the fare was too small, the cab wouldn't take me to the train station. I thought, you know what, I'm going to walk. And guess what? The heavens opened. But I weren't bothered about getting wet. I'm still wet now. I thought, you know what, bugger it, I'll walk. You're not ripping me off. Now, anybody else, oh yeah, doesn't mind. Yeah, take me 30 quid for a mile up the road. That's not how I think. Oh, I can't take you. He's looked at, I can't get you all in here. There's two of us. I said, no problem, mate. See you later. Let's walk. I've got two legs.
I think that is a perfect note for us to say thank you very much for sharing today. I mean, I know people come here to listen about money and finance, but I think that you've shared so many insights and thoughts and experiences that people need to translate into every aspect of their life, in particular their finances, their investing and their trading. That modesty, that idea of protecting yourself, don't worry about what other people are doing, learn for yourself. So many things that I've just taken from like this short time with you. So I want to say thank you.
I want to say thank you for listening to me. Another thing I'll tell you before I go as well.
Please.
If you listen to other people, 9 times out of 10, you won't succeed. If you get a feeling that's good and it suits you, run with it. You know, because at the end of the day, everybody's got an opinion. But if you have not got the mindset to appreciate what's in your pocket, you're going nowhere in life. Appreciate the job you're in. Do it to the best of your ability and get the best out of it. And rewards are terrific, aren't they?
I mean, you've ended the show better than I ever could have. So thank you very much. Cheers.
Appreciate you.
What an episode, Gabriel. We learned so much from great people with a lot of experience, you know, actually. I won't lie. My young self really shown today that, yes, I just turned 23, but I'm not a big man, no way. You know, starting off with Marc Walton, who's a pro veteran trader. I think what I took from him was more about how much time he had to go through the losses. And, you know, I've gone through similar things in my journey. So understanding that, yes, when your back is against the wall, it's a resilience that puts you through. Which leads us on to the next guest, which was John. What would you say you learned from him?
Oh, Mr. John Fury humbled us, didn't he, a little bit?
Oh, to the max.
I mean, even myself sitting here as a guy that talks about personal finance on the internet, just a few lines from John Fury that I want to reshare, which was the idea of him and his son, Tyson, multi-millionaires, flying on Ryanair. It's like, I know that like we know that it happens, but I really think that it resembles how wrong a lot of people have gone when it comes to money and how these extrinsic things really don't matter. And if the people with millions of pounds are acting in such a way, surely you can take a look in the mirror. I can take a look in the mirror. And I know there are extremes and there's also a way to like live a life with a bit of luxury. Of course, that's what we all want. But there were so many lessons that people can take listening to that and just realizing that maybe take a step back and live below your means. Those are the magic words that I'm going to take away from John. I'm also quite happy because we went 3 rounds with him just then back and forth and survived in the ring. So there we go.
Yeah, no, definitely. And again, they all have similarities, even with our previous guests as well. With the trading side, it's all about being resilient, always going through and staying disciplined, whether it's boxing or in the trading markets. So it's great that there's similarities between everything that all of our guests have said. Mm. And they all watched previous episodes and referred back to. So it's great. It's working and they're loving it.
I mean, it just shows that with trading and with life, there's these just core principles you need to live by. And then our guests come in and they sprinkle a little bit more, something different here and there.
So I'm loving it. And that makes me so, so excited for what we've got coming up next, Poku. So who's first on the show next time?
Yeah, next actually, the one and only Tickmill. We've got Patrick Monnelly, who's actually managing multi-million dollars worth of capital. And he's gonna, I'm going to learn a lot because, again, to start with that capital, the discipline, the mindset, the strategy, it has to be at a different level. You know, this ain't just retail. No, this is big. This is big corporate stuff. So I won't lie, I would love to learn from him. I can't wait to have him in the hot seat, ask him all the questions. Who else have we got next?
We're also then going to have João Paulo Pacifico. I'm pretty sure that I got that right. And he's flying in from Brazil. He's the CEO of Impact Investing, at part of the Gaia Group, I believe. And he's also one of the top voices with over almost 500,000 followers on LinkedIn. So this guy is well-renowned, a CEO, and he's specifically going to share with us a little bit about impact investing, you know, social responsibility, doing things the right way, being a good CEO, someone with a positive, you know, attribution towards the world, towards nature, towards our society, and towards sustainability. So I think that's a really important lesson, and I hope people tune in because I know that we're going to learn a lot in that lesson.
Definitely. I can't wait. And, you know, impact investing, I think a lot of people here thinking we're all about money, but no, you also can find ways to make money and also impact the world. So definitely that'd be great to learn from.
They're not mutually exclusive, are they?
Not at all.
Anyway,
it's time to trade thoughts.
Yes, Poku.
Let's give it.